Hi, my name is Belinda Kasim Kaminski. I'm a writer and visual artist based in Vienna, Austria. It is an honor to be part of this conference. My contribution is called Page 46, Line 2 from Below. When I first hold a map to the door of no return, notes to belonging in my hands, there is this immediate pull, the feeling that it will take me to places I had not thought of, left alone imagined, locations I have not yet connected to. I'm sucked into map, just like into a vortex. I underline and highlight, I excerpt and transcribe sections and send them to friends. I follow the on-brand across harbors and train stations, visiting Toronto, Mannheim, Elmina, Daughters of the Dust, or Toni Morrison's Paradise, until I run ashore on page 46, line 2 from below. I will stay there for some time, soul stranded, memories once discarded overrunning me, thrown back from the open sea to the location I inhabit, Austria, a country in the middle of Europe, in which the mainstream still claims that there is no colonial history, left alone Black her stories. Wrestling with this location has been part of my life and practice since day one. I'm used to being inspired by books that do not take into consideration Austria when speaking about the African diaspora. I imagine myself as part of conversations that are usually maintained without considering that Black people indeed do love, imagine, die, and make life in this very location. Allow me to read this tiny passage. Guardian Weekly, March 30 to April 5, 2000, Austria. In January this year, when police raided the home of Black Africans in Treskirchen, 140 police stormed the home looking for drugs, but nothing was found, he, a witness, said. They then carried out painful anal searches simply because there was some suspicion that there might be drugs here. All you need is a Black face to be considered suspicious. The focal point of Amnesty's allegations is the case of 26-year-old Marcus Omofumo. I'm stopped by two currents that set in motion long-forgotten memories. Marcus Omofumo, a 26-year-old Nigerian who became known to the world via his death, and Treskirchen, a town in Lower Austria in which my sister used to live for a while. Treskirchen is connected to Vienna by a blue and white train called Badnerbahn, a one-hour train ride I frequently take. Since 1955, one of the biggest housings for refugees in Austria has been located in Treskirchen. In German, it is called Flüchtlingslager. Unsurprisingly, the building used to be a cadet school in the Austrian Habsburg monarchy. In the 90s and 2000s, the atmosphere in Treskirchen is loaded. The locals feel overtaken by the newcomers. The former want to get rid of the latter and the refugee housing by any means necessary. Coming across the town's name unexpectedly while reading map, a place I had not thought about for more than 15 years, I'm reminded of myself as a 13-year-old walking down the streets and feeling even more stared at than usual. In this town, I always felt aware of my body, of the ways I'm navigating and taking up space. All you need is a Black face to be considered suspicious. My sister is white, and she does not understand why I insist on being picked up from the train station. I do not know how long Marcus Omofumo was forced to stay in Treskirchen. All I know is that after his plea for asylum was declined twice, he was taken into custody for 1 year in Vienna. His final destination, deportation to Nigeria. It is the 1st of May, 1999, an airplane heading to Sofia, Bulgaria. He's flanked by three police officers. They tape his upper body, mouth, and parts of his nose. They refuse air to him. He's not able to breathe. Once the plane lands, Marcus Omofuma is declared dead by Bulgarian doctors. Reading his name and immediately seeing the newspaper coverage about his case in front of my inner eye reminds me of the fear and terror I felt in 1991 when I saw the video of Rodney King's beating. I'm reminded of the ways in which Omofuma's death sparked nationwide protest of the Black community in Austria. I think back to a poster I designed with Araba Evelyn Johnston Arthur in 2008 for an exhibition. On it, we listed names of Black people who suffered violence at the hands of police. Many of them were, in fact, murdered by the police. Richard Ibekwe, 2nd of May, 2000. Yankuba Sesai, 4th of October, 2005. Elaine B., 15th of January, 2004. Semira Adamu, 23rd of September, 1998. African Diasporan Cartography in the Making, a timeline connecting locations and people, a map. A map to the door of no return, notes to belonging carries within all the brutal arithmetics of marooned life and time making. Still, it also carries all the beauty. While I'm being thrown back and forward through various time spaces, I'm provided with lifelines, navigational information, with routes and tides, the stars, the taste and flavor of the waters. I am being held. Whenever I open the pages of map, I return to intense feelings of connection and belonging, acknowledging that it is not about routes, but the routes. The gathering of routes as ongoing acts of world and map making. Black freedom as horizon, we gather navigational instructions along the way. Dion Brand, thank you for gifting me, for gifting us with map.